Well, this is Bible study, Tuesday night. Good evening, everybody out there on Facebook. Thank you for joining us. And thank you for all you for joining us here in person. So we are going to continue on in a journey that we've started back with Pesach, Passover. And we're coming up to our next feast, which we all know is Shavuot. And so we are talking about on Sabbath about how we are in the midst of the counting of the Omer. And we're talking about that journey of what we're supposed to be doing and the reflections are supposed to be taking place and examinations and everything. So we're going to continue with that. And what we're going to focus on tonight is we are now in week 6 of the counting of the Omer, in day 37. So interesting, last week was about humility. And we were talking about how Yahweh does things in a certain way. So we're building a foundation, and he builds upon and builds upon. So we need humility to get that right, to come into this week, to make sure we get this right. So the week that we have come into, week number 6, is the week of bonding. So that is what we're going to be talking about tonight. We're going to be going on, yay, a journey of bonding, okay? So we're going to look at a lot of word. It's always good to look at a lot of word. Amen. So we're going to go in the journey of bonding, and then we're going to end. Today is actually day 37, right? Saturday was 34, Sunday was 30. Today's 37. So we're going to look, like we did on Sabbath, we looked specifically at day 34. So now we're going to look at towards the end, day 37. But anyway, so we are going to be talking about this week, which is the week of bonding. And I know maybe for some people, I can say definitely for me, you hear bonding and kind of your insides go, ah, you know. And kind of like lately for me over the last couple months, different things that I've talked about, my insides have gone, ah, because it's like, okay, Yahweh is trying to get something out to us, you know, not just me, but all of us. And he brings these things about because he knows these are things that we need to change in our lives. He knows that we need to change these things so that we can go to a higher level with him. Because, you know, if we're bound up with walls and all this stuff, we can't get to that true place with Yahweh like we're intended on going. We can't do what he's called us to do fully unless we get certain things corrected and established in our lives. So we're going to look, like I said, at bonding. And actually, I'm going to give my definition first. You know, we have I guess what it would be, English class when we do bond, you know, the definitions and stuff. So just to go over before we jump into this journey, bonding. So bonding means it's the establishment of a relationship or link with someone based on shared feelings, interests, or experiences. Another definition of it is the action of joining things securely. So there's many different aspects of bonding, okay? You see aspects of bonding in relationship-wise. You can look at aspects of bonding with materials. You need to bond one material to another type of thing. There's all different types of forms of bonding. And actually, when you look into all the different ones, even with the material bonding, you can see the concept within it, which how it can apply to relationship bonding. It's really interesting when you do the whole research part of it. But what we're going to be talking about tonight is bonding between people with relationships, okay? And I know a lot of what we go over through this will say, you know, when you talk about bonding, it's about bonding with someone or something. All right, we're not gonna really look at the something part, although you can have a healthy bonding of something, you know, but we're gonna focus on the healthy bonding of people with each other, because that's the most important. That's the thing that we need to perfect. You know, how well I bond with my cat, even though I may have a very good bond with my cat, you know, isn't going to really help me when it comes to the things Yahweh has called me to do that involves people. We all know people are a lot different than animals, okay? You know, we need to value people higher than we value animals. I know some people have different ideas on that, you know, I'd rather have my cat as my closest friend than a person, okay? But that's not the way Yahweh intended it. So, bonding. Bonding typically refers to the process of attachment that develops between two people. So, actually, let's look at scripture first. Let's go to Ecclesiastes chapter 4, and we're going to look at verses 9 through 12. And this is in the complete Jewish Bible. And, you know, there's some interesting things all throughout the Bible about bonding and stuff. But when I was doing all this, this was the scripture that dropped into my head instantly, because it says it in a lot of different ways. But Ecclesiastes 4, 9 through 12 in the complete Jewish Bible says, and catch what we're talking about, okay? The emphasis is on two people. Even though it's going to refer to one, the emphasis is on two people. Now, how many of you know that in order to have a bonding relationship, you need two people, correct? Okay, you can't bond with yourself. Okay. Well, I guess you could. Like, you could bond with yourself, but that's not what he's talking about here. He's talking about bonding with another person, okay? So, two are better than one in that their cooperative efforts yield this advantage. If one of them falls, the other will help his partner up. Woe to him who is alone when he falls and has no one to help him up. Again, if two people sleep together, they keep each other warm, but how can one person be warm by himself? Moreover, an attacker may defeat someone who is alone, but two can resist him, and a three-stranded cord is not easily broken. There's another translation that talks about the bind of that three-stranded cord. So you notice in that scripture, what were we talking about? We're talking about two individuals. So like the first part of that, you know, if one falls, the other will help his partner up. This scripture is talking about the bond between two people. So if two people are sleeping in bed together, okay, and they keep each other warm. Normally when you think about, you know, when you think, okay, you're sleeping in bed with somebody to keep each other warm, do you think it's referring to like a person and then like, you know, the guy that they just walked out of 7-Eleven or something like that, you know, to keep each other warm? That's not what they're talking about. They're talking about a bond between a relationship, okay? It's not just like two people that don't know each other or whatever. They're talking about a bond in a relationship. And so, you know, an attacker may defeat someone who is alone, but two can resist him. We always know in a bonding relationship, a relationship that's really secure and tight and intimate, the one always has the other's back. And you know that, you know that. You know that there's no question that if, like it just says, if one falls, the other one's going to be right there to pick him up. You know, if somebody's going after one, you know what, you got to get through the other person to get to them. That whole type of thing. So we're actually going to look at two examples in the Bible that are probably, I think, are the two most important, two most, I'm not quite sure the word of it, two most detailed accounts of what it means to have a bonding relationship. And the first one we're going to look at is the story of Ruth and Naomi. And then after that, we're going to look at David and Jonathan. And I found it interesting, you know, two of the most, probably the two most bonding relationships in the Bible, outside of maybe Yeshua and John, because they had obviously had a bonding relationship, a close relationship, was Ruth and Naomi and David and Jonathan. And interestingly, when you look at this in the Bible, the two events take place side by side. You come to the book of Ruth, and you read about Ruth and Naomi. Then right in the very next book is 1 Samuel. The very next book is 1 Samuel, and it's the story of David and Jonathan. So I found that very interesting, looking at the whole aspect of things. But so we're going to look first at Ruth and Naomi. And we're going to, you know what, we're actually going to read not the entire book. You know, they read the book of Ruth at Shavuot. You know, we're not going to do that. We're not going to read the entire book of Ruth. But we are going to read the first chapter of Ruth so we can get an idea of what this is talking about. And we're very well grained in here. We've known about Ruth and Naomi for a long time. You know, Dad has taught on Ruth and Naomi. Mom has taught on Ruth and Naomi. But there's so much when you delve deep into it. There's so much to pull out of it. There's so many nuggets of things that we can learn on. And the story of Ruth and Naomi, we can learn so much from just the first chapter of that interaction with Ruth towards Naomi with the topic of bonding. Now keep this all in mind, because like I said, we are now week 6 and we're in the week of bonding. And every day we're supposed to be developing, perfecting, re-examining a characteristic that has to do with this, okay? So, the book of Ruth, chapter 1. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem of Judah went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he, his wife, and his two sons. The man's name was Elimelech, and his wife's name was Naomi, and his two sons were named Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephratites from Bethlehem of Judah. They went to the country of Moab and continued there. But Elimelech, who was Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. And they took two wives of the women of Moab. The name of the one was Orpah, and the other, the name of the other, Ruth. They dwelt there about 10 years. And Mahlon and Chilion died also, both of them. So the woman was bereft of her two sons and her husband. Then she arose with her daughters-in-law to return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in Moab how the Lord had visited his people and given them food. So she left the place where she was, her two daughter-in-laws with her, and they started on their way back to Judah. But Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go, return each of you to her mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find a home and rest, each in the house of her husband." Then she kissed them and they wept aloud. And they said to her, "No, we will return with you to your people." Now notice right there for a moment. They both said to her at that point, "No, we will return with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters, go, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say I have hope, even if I should have a husband tonight and should bear sons, would you therefore wait till they were grown? Would you therefore refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, it is far more bitter for me than for you that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me." Then they wept aloud again, and Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye, but Ruth clung to her. Now catch that key thing right there too. So what happened? You know, at first they're up, both of them are saying, "No, we're following you." But then Naomi says all that, and Orpah makes a decision and decides, nope, you know what? I'm going back. I'm going back to my mother's house and stuff like that. But what did Ruth do? But Ruth clung to her. You know, and it's interesting the choice of words. And now this is out of the Amplified, and there's different translations and stuff. But what do you think of when you hear the word clung? When somebody clings to you, okay? So I know like when my daughter gets up in the morning and she gives me a good morning hug and she's hugging me, she's clinging to me and she's like, "Oh, mommy, I don't want to let you go." You know, you feel that affection and that love coming from that person. They're clinging to you. You know, or in another instance, like this with Ruth and Naomi. You know, Ruth was clinging to Naomi in an act of, "No, I will never leave you. Don't make me leave you." Almost kind of this determination that I'm not going to leave you. I'm clinging to you with everything that I have. And that type of, you know, that's a strong word in the sense of how it's used. The fact that she clung to Naomi. You know, can you think of like too many people that when you're giving them a hug goodbye or whatever, that you cling to them? Or you just say a hug or what? You know the people that when you go to give them a hug goodbye or, you know, say, good example. So when y'all left for Israel and left Nicole and I back here, okay, a few years back, remember? Okay, everybody else departed. You guys didn't leave us, but everybody else departed, and Nicole and I were the two that were back here holding down the fort, okay? Now, at that day when we came to say bye to everybody, okay, that was a moment, if I dare say, of clinging that took place, okay? I know there was many people that Nicole and I clung to, like, "Take us with you, put us in your suitcase if you have to," okay? But what was that? You know, as we were saying goodbye to each other and stuff like that, and we knew we were going to see each other again, but there was this like, "Oh, I'm not letting you go." Even though you're only going to be gone for 2 weeks, at that time, only 2 weeks seemed more like 2 years, okay? It's like, "Oh, day one, it's only been day one," okay? And then the next day it's like, "It's only been day two, it's already felt like it's been 2 weeks. Come on, people, come back," okay? But that, you know, so That was an example of clinging, okay? That was an example of holding on to somebody with much affection and I'm going to miss you so much. And you can feel, you know, Mom talks about the importance of touch all the time, okay? And you can feel the transference of the affection and stuff. You on purpose release. So I know there were certain people that I was hugging goodbye, and it was like, you know, I'm clinging on to you, and I hope you can feel what's coming out of me inside of you. It's not bad, it's all good, because it's like, I don't want you leaving, okay? It's that, no, don't go. Even though you have to go, even though you're gonna be back, it's how you feel towards that person that may be leaving. You know, I remember many, many times, and it still happens, but, you know, Mom and Dad would leave, and they'd go to Florida or whatever, and I would be in a state of just absolute despair, kind of like Anne and from Anne of Green Gables, you know? I'd be in the depths of despair that Mom left, you know, the next couple of days or whatever, because that's how, you know, when you're in a bond with somebody, that's how you feel. When that person leaves, it's like a part of you left with them, okay? That's what a true bond is. When someone goes away, it's like a part of you goes with them, and it's like, oh, you know, I'm gonna miss you, you're gonna be gone, you know, like the example for Israel, you know, and that shows the depth of the bond that a lot of us in here have developed. And I believe, I dare to say, that it's gotten even stronger over the last year, okay? It definitely has gotten a lot stronger over the last year. But I can remember times of, you know, kind of, well, still now, I hide it a little bit better, but I remember times of like crying when Mom and Dad would be driving away, you know, and it's like, oh, for goodness sakes, I'm, you know, 35 years old and I'm crying because Mom's leaving. But it is different. There's a reason why. And it's because of that intense bond that you have with a person, you know, and not just Mom. I mean, I'd cry. I remember my trip to Haiti. I had gone to Haiti without Scott. And it was like, oh my goodness, it was such a, I'm not sure what to call it, but it was like being away from him. And I remember, I think we were in the airport in Florida, and Dad was like, you need to call him, you know, and I called him, and it was just like, it was just such a moving experience. And it was like, oh, being away from him, it's like, I couldn't imagine being away from him. And especially for that amount of time, and especially where I'm going to Haiti, and I might not be able to call him every day. You know, I might not be able to communicate with him on a daily basis. You know, I felt that same exact way about Mom. It's like, well, even though she's only going to like Maine, for goodness sakes, you know, but still, you know, when that person that you truly value and love and they're a part of you is not in your presence at that moment, it impacts you. And that's the type of relationships we're supposed to have with people. You know, it's like when someone goes, someone that I'm really close to, they leave to go somewhere or do something, whatever, it's like a part of me left with them type of thing, because you're so attached and bonded to them. So that is all examples. So Ruth clung to Naomi. And it was like, no, I am not leaving you. I am clinging to you. I don't care what you do. I don't care, you know, if I'm dragging you along like this, okay? I'm coming with you type of thing. So, verse 15, and Naomi said, see, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law. Now, Naomi is trying to persuade Ruth, you know, go, my daughter. You'll have a better life. You know, go. Ruth saw her sister-in-law leave. That could be a little bit of a temptation. Okay, well, my sister-in-law did it, you know. You know, maybe the better life is out there, but that's not what Ruth was looking at. Ruth obviously connected to Naomi in a deeper level than her sister-in-law had, and it started back at the beginning. And it all comes down to covenant. That's what bonding all comes down to, covenant. When you have a real covenant with somebody, you have true bonding, that bond can never be broken. Just like that scripture in Ecclesiastes talks about the three stranded cord is not easily broken. That's because you have a covenant that's taken place. And you know, covenant with Yahweh will never break his covenant with us or alter it, right? So, and Ruth said, urge me not to leave you or to turn back from following you, for where you go, I will go. And these are powerful words, what Ruth says to Naomi. For where you go, I will go. and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts me from you. Those words that Ruth spoke to Naomi, those were powerful, powerful covenant words. And that right there shows just a powerful, perfect example of bonding between two individuals, what true bonding is, what true commitment is, what true relationship is supposed to be about. You know, look at the verse 17, where you die, I will die. Now, Ruth was a totally different, you know, heritage, so to speak, of Naomi. But it was like, you know what, where you die, I will die. Do you know, like, of too many people that you would say something like that? Where you die, I will die. You know, some of us are like, well, you know, you get caught up in different things. But it's like when you really understand covenant and you understand what Yahweh has created as relationship and bonding, you'll grab a hold of what Ruth had with Naomi. And that's what it's supposed to be about. So when we get this perfect and we walk this out the way we're supposed to walk it out, it'll enable us to be free and do what we're supposed to do with the people outside these doors. You know, we talked about on Sabbath about humility and stuff like that. And what is humility? Humility is the absence of pride or arrogance, okay? You can't witness to somebody the way you're supposed to, the way that Yahweh would if you're a proud, arrogant person, okay? Because it's going to be all about you getting somebody to the Lord. It's not going to be about Yahweh. It's going to be all about you. But the next part of verse 17, I think, is a very strong example of covenant and bonding, where it says, the Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts me from you. So Ruth is saying to Naomi, you know what? The only thing that would get me away from you, that would to try to separate me from you, would have to be death. That's a powerful, powerful statement to say to somebody. Powerful statement. And when you make that type of commitment like that, that's when you know you're in it for good. You're in it for the long haul. You're in it not for you, you're in it for the other person. Because that's what bonding's about. Bonding's not about what do I get out of it? I'm not doing it for me. Bonding's about the other person. And the other person, when they're doing their thing, that's for them about you. But, you know, we're focusing on ourselves here individually and what we're doing for the other person. So for Ruth to be like that with Naomi, you know, and there's so much more in that that's so deeper to delve into for a lack of time. You know, I mean, we could go on verses 16 and 17. You know, we could turn it into a sermon series probably. Maybe Jordan and Mom and I will do that down the road or something. You know, I think that would be actually very interesting, powerful. But when you're willing to look at stuff like that and do things like that, then there's this whole thing that breaks free, and there's a freedom that takes place, and you become who you really are. You know, like Jordan said, be the best version of you can possibly be. Well, you know, I'd say right here that Ruth was being the best version of herself that she could possibly be to Naomi. Because also, what did this entail? So bonding, when you bond with somebody, and I'm getting ahead of myself, but that's okay. When you're bonding with somebody, in order to have, you know, you just don't, like I said at the beginning, you don't just bond with anybody, okay? So I'm just not going to go down to Market Basket and bond with the first cashier, with the exception of Unique. I'm not going to bond with whoever the cashier is on register one, okay? Just saying. Who knows who it would be, okay? But there's specific individuals that Yahweh has called us to bond with and to become relationship with. So like with Ruth and Naomi, with Ruth's commitment to Naomi, she displayed an amazing trust. So, you know, we could read the whole book, like I said, but we're not going to for sake of time. But when you go on and read about the story between Ruth and Naomi, Ruth had amazing, amazing trust and confidence in who Naomi was and what Naomi knew to follow the things that Naomi told her to do. Okay, there were certain things that Naomi told her to do, and it'd be like, okay, you know, go lie at Boaz's feet. It'd be like, what do you mean? What are you telling me? Go lie at some guy's feet? You know, right? Okay, no. She never even questioned it. And that's a key sign right there. She never questioned it. Naomi said, Ruth did. Okay? There was no question. There was no doubt. She has such 100% trust and confidence in Naomi. And what was that circle back around on? Because she knew Naomi would never steer her wrong. Okay? This is a powerful lesson to apply to our mother of this church, okay? She knew that Naomi would never steer her wrong. She knew that Naomi was only telling her what to do because she knew the success and victory that was going to bring to Ruth. She knew things that Ruth didn't know, okay? All of us sitting in here, we know things not of, okay? But mom does. So for all of us, you know, same thing, you know? When like I said, when Naomi told her to do, Ruth did. And we know the end of the story. What happened with Ruth? Okay, amazing, amazing thing, and it leads us to Yeshua. Because she had this amazing trust and confidence in Naomi and a love, a bond that was never going to be broken. Like she said, the only thing that would ever break that bond would be death. Only thing. And that's powerful, okay? But because she knew that Naomi was looking out for her. She knew that Naomi was looking for her best interest. She knew that Naomi wanted her to succeed. Okay? Like I said, we can have a powerful, powerful lesson in this. We compare Ruth and Naomi to us and our spiritual mother. And we'll leave it at that, because we could go on that and this could go in a whole other direction. But anyways, we need to stay focused on the week of bonding. But learn some things from Ruth and Naomi, okay, because it does apply to us. You know, we have a Naomi in our midst, okay? We have more than a Naomi in our midst. But the same thing with mom. You know, when mom says, do. When mom says, do. Don't question. Most of the times when we question, that gets us into trouble, okay? We cause our own challenges. But just like with Naomi with Ruth, you know, Naomi wasn't really gaining. I mean, she gained out of that. Don't hear me wrong when I say she's not really gained. But Ruth was the one. Okay, Ruth was the one that propelled into a destiny that she never would have had before if she had followed in the steps of her sister-in-law. Okay? So a whole other rabbit trail you could go on, but keep your eyes off your sister-in-law. Okay? Because if you had followed the path of certain family members, that path following certain family members probably going to lead you to a road of destruction instead of keeping your eyes on the path of the true one that you're in covenant and bonding with. Amen? So that was with Ruth and Naomi. And like I said, we could go on to a whole big thing about that. But for lack of time, we're going to move on. So bonding breeds bonding. And when you bond in one area of your life, it helps you bond in other areas. So, you know, obviously bonding, in order to bond, we had 5 previous weeks where Yahweh was leading us through certain steps to take. And each thing built on another. So, you know, the layers of brick got higher and higher and higher, and we're building our foundation. And so when you bond in one area, it helps you to bond in others. So, you know, if Yahweh is leading you, you know, you know, bonding takes 2 people, like I said. So you're able to victoriously bond with an individual that you know Yahweh's called you to. And it becomes so much easier now to be able to create a relationship with another person that Yahweh has led you to. So let's look at the next one, and that is going to be with David and Jonathan. So let's turn to 1 Samuel. And, you know, and just, you're going to see very similar things between David and Jonathan that took place between Ruth and Naomi. So you have 2 examples, Ruth and Naomi, 2 females. David and Jonathan, 2 males, okay? And healthy relationships, okay? Nowadays, the world would look at something like David and Jonathan and think other things, okay? And unfortunately, because of the world we live in, but that's not the case, okay? Yahweh created relationships, okay? Yahweh created covenant. He created bonding. You know, in the story with David and Jonathan, they were two men who bonded with each other on such a deep level from Yahweh that was totally, totally right. Totally was the thing that was supposed to happen. So 1 Samuel, we're going to look at 1 Samuel chapter 18. Actually, so we know the story, 1 Samuel 17, David. All right, so David went out and fought the big giant, right? He went and took care of Goliath and stuff. And so this how Samuel, David gets introduced to Saul, the whole relationship between David and Saul. So just to back up to paint a little bit of a picture, the last two verses in chapter 17, 57 and 58. When David returned from killing Goliath the Philistine, Abner brought him before Saul with the head of the Philistine in his hand. And Saul said to him, "Whose son are you, young man?" And David answered, "I am the son of your servant Jesse of Bethlehem." Now chapter 18. Now catch this, okay, just like catching certain things with Ruth and Naomi. There are key words, key phrases throughout these scriptures. So when David had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own life. You know, this is the first time we actually hear Jonathan. Okay, we just came out of the story of David and Goliath. You know, Jonathan wasn't in the picture anywhere there. But then all of a sudden, obviously Jonathan was present when David and Saul were talking. So when David had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own life. So knit with the soul of David. The soul of Jonathan was bonded with the soul of David. And it happened like that. It was and Yahweh can do that, a supernatural bond, a supernatural knitting. Then verse 2, Saul took David that day and would not let him return to his father's house. Verse 3, then Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as his own life. And we know that's what covenant is. Covenant is about the other person. Covenant is about loving the other person. I would dare say, you know, it's as much as you love yourself, as more than you love yourself. You know, the other covenant means the other person comes first. You know, covenant is all about the other person. And that's what bonding is. Bonding is all tied up with that. Bonding, when you bond with somebody, you know, David and Jonathan had this powerful, powerful bond, just like with Ruth and Naomi. They had this powerful bond. And as you can see here, and you see it on both their ends, but you see it more displayed on Jonathan because of his actions and stuff, okay? Jonathan went against his own father, the king, okay? Because of his bond with David. Jonathan did things to save David's life, and express certain things to David because of his bond with him. It all comes back around to the bond that David and Jonathan had. So let's go jump down to, chapter 19. And I'm going to actually read the whole story of chapter 19 because this shows you who Jonathan was and how he felt about David. And it shows you the bond that the two of them had together. Now Saul told Jonathan his son and all his servants that they must kill David. Now, obviously, Saul had a trust in Jonathan, he was a son, okay? He had a trust in Jonathan, so he came right out and told Jonathan, okay, we're going to kill David. Well, how do you think Jonathan felt about that, okay? I don't think he was a little happy about that, okay? Jonathan was going to take it upon himself to be like, you know what? No, you're not. You know, it's kind of one of those things, you have to get through me if you're going to get to him, okay? So, but Jonathan, Saul's son, delighted much in David. And he told David, "Saul, my father, is seeking to kill you. Now, therefore, take heed to yourself in the morning and stay in a secret place and hide yourself." Now, you have to know also that Jonathan was putting himself at stake, at risk, okay? But did that matter to him? No, because of the bond he had with David, he was putting David above himself. And at that point, Jonathan didn't care what happened to him. His thoughts more were with David and protecting David. "So, and I will go out and stand beside my father in the field where you are, and I will converse with my father about you, and if I learn anything, I will tell you. And Jonathan spoke well of David to Saul his father and said to him, let not the king sin against his servant David, for he has not sinned against you, and his deeds have been of good service to you. For he took his life in his hands and slew the Philistine, and the Lord wrought a great deliverance for all Israel. You saw it and rejoiced. Why then will you sin against innocent blood and kill David without a cause? Saul heeded Jonathan and swore, as the Lord lives, David shall not be slain. So Jonathan called David and told him all these things. And Jonathan brought David to Saul, and he was in his presence as in times past. Then there was war again, and David went out and fought with the Philistines and made a great slaughter among them, and they fled before him. Then an evil spirit came upon Saul as he sat in his house with his spear in his hand, and David was playing the lyre with his hand. Saul sought to pin David to the wall with the spear, but he slipped away, so that Saul struck the spear into the wall. Then David fled and escaped that night. Saul sent messengers that night to David's house to watch him, that he might kill him in the morning. But Michal, David's wife, told him, if you do not save your life tonight, tomorrow you will be killed. So Michal let David down through the window, and he fled and escaped. And Michal took the teraph and laid it in the bed. It put a pillow of goat's hair at its head and covered it with a bedspread. And when Saul sent messengers to take David, she said, he is sick. Then Saul sent the messengers again to see David, saying, bring him up to me in the bed that I may slay him. And when the messengers came in, behold, there was an image in the bed with a pillow of goat's hair at its head. Saul said to Michal, why have you deceived me so and sent away my enemy so that he has escaped? Michal answered Saul, he said to me, let me go. Why should I kill you? So David fled and escaped and came to Samuel at Ramah and told him all that Saul had done to him. And he and Samuel went and dwelt in Naioth. And it was told Saul, behold, David is at Naioth in Ramah. And Saul sent messages to take David. And when they saw the company of the prophets prophesying and Samuel standing as appointed head over them, the Spirit of God came upon the messengers of Saul. And they also prophesied. When it was told, he sent other messengers, and they also prophesied and sent Saul messengers against the heart third time, and they also prophesied. So now we're going to skip down to verse chapter 20. David fled from Naioth in Ramah and came and said to Jonathan, what have I done? Of what am I guilty? What is my sin before your father that he seeks my life? Jonathan said, God forbid, you shall not die. My father does nothing great or small but what he tells me. And why should he hide this thing from me? It is not so. Now, Jonathan already had it made up in his mind. You know what? I'm helping you. I got your back. I'm going to cover you. But David replied, your father certainly knows that I have found favor in your eyes. And he thinks, let not Jonathan know this, lest he be grieved. But truly as the Lord lives and as your soul lives, there is but a step between me and death. Then Jonathan said to David, whatever you desire, I will do for you. Same thing as Ruth and Naomi. Naomi said, Ruth did. The same thing with Jonathan with David. He said it right there. Whatever you desire, I will do for you. David, and that's a strong word to say, it's a strong statement to make. Whatever you desire. Okay, that's kind of like a loaded statement to make. You know, it's like, whatever you desire, I will do for you. David said to Jonathan, tomorrow is the new moon festival, and I should not fail to sit at the table with the king. But let me go that I may hide myself in the field till the third day at evening. If your father misses me at all, then say, David earnestly asked leave of me that he might run to Bethlehem, his city, for there is a yearly sacrifice there for all the family. If he says all right, then it will be well with your servant. But if he is angry, then be sure that evil is determined by him. Therefore, deal kindly with your servant, for you have brought me into a covenant of the Lord with you. And that's where it all comes down to, the covenant between David and Jonathan, the bond. Just like with Naomi and Ruth, the covenant and the bond they had is the same powerful thing taking place between David and Jonathan. But if there is guilt in me, kill me yourself, for why should you bring me to your father? And Jonathan said, far be it from you. If I knew that evil was determined for you by my father, would I not tell you? Then said David to Jonathan, who will tell me if your father answers you roughly? Jonathan said, come, let us go into the field. So they went into the field. You know, see this whole picture created. Okay, visualize this as we're reading it. This thing taking place between Jonathan and David. This whole conversation that's taking place to them is a demonstration and display of the bond that they have with each other. So Jonathan said, come, let us go into the field. So they went into the field. Jonathan said to David, the Lord, the God of Israel, be witness. When I have sounded out my father about this time tomorrow or the third day, behold, if he is well inclined toward David, and I do not send and let you know it, the Lord do so and much more to Jonathan. But if it please my father to do you harm, then I will disclose it to you and send you away, that you may go in safety. And may the Lord be with you as he has been with my father. While I am still alive, you shall not only show me the loving kindness of the Lord, so that I die not, but also you shall not cut off your kindness from my house forever. No, not even when the Lord has cut off every enemy of David from the face of the earth. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, and the Lord will require that this covenant be kept at the hands of David's enemies. And Jonathan caused David to swear again by his love for him, for Jonathan loved him as he loved his own life. You know, and jump forward a little bit, that whole thing that just took place between Jonathan and David. We remember the whole story about after when Jonathan is killed, okay, and it's just David and how, you know, distraught and everything David was. And what did David say? Is there anybody left in the house of Jonathan? Anybody left? And what happens? He finds his son, Mephibosheth, right? Yes. Is that how you say it? Did I say it right? Okay. Finds his son, who lived in Lodabar, okay, and we know about that town, all right? But what did he do? He went and he got his son, and he brought him out of the depths of despair, okay? He brought him out of the most lowly place that he could be in, and what happened? Overnight, he was elevated, okay, in the king's presence. He was brought into a blessed life, all back down to covenant because of the covenant that Jonathan had with David and that strong bond that took place. So then Jonathan said to David, verse 18, tomorrow is the new moon festival and you will be missed, for your seat will be empty. On the third day you will go quickly and come to the place where you hid yourself when the matter was in hand and remain by the stone Azel. And I will shoot 3 arrows on the side of it as though I shot at a mark. And I will send a lad saying, go, find the arrows. If I expressly say to the lad, look, the arrows are on this side of you, take them. Then you are to come, for it is safe for you and there is no danger as the Lord lives. But if I say to the youth, look, the arrows are beyond you, then go, for the Lord has sent you away. And as touching the matter of which you and I have spoken, behold, the Lord is between you and me forever. You know, we see powerful words again spoken in this bond, this relationship between David and Jonathan. So David hid himself in the field, and when the new moon festival came, the king sat down to eat food. The king sat, as at other times, on his seat by the wall, and Jonathan sat opposite. And Abner sat by Saul's side, but David's place was empty. Yet Saul said nothing that day, for he thought, something has befallen him, and he is not clean. Surely he is not clean. But on the morrow, the second day after the new moon, David's place was empty. And Saul said to Jonathan, his son, why has not the son of Jesse come to the meal, either yesterday or today? And Jonathan answered, David earnestly asked leave of me to go to Bethlehem. He said, let me go, I pray, for our family holds a sacrifice in the city, and my brother commanded me to be there. Now if I have found favor in your eyes, let me get away and see my brothers. That is why he has not come to the king's table. Then Saul's anger was kindled against Jonathan. Now you know Jonathan knew that was going to happen. Okay, he knew what the risk that he was taking. But you know what? David came first. David was his priority. You son of a perverse, rebellious woman, do not I know that you have chosen the son of Jesse to your own shame and to the shame of your mother who bore you? For as long as the son of Jesse lives upon the earth, you shall not be established, nor shall your kingdom. So now send and bring him to me, for he shall surely die. Jonathan answered Saul his father, why should he be killed? What has he done? But Saul cast his spear at him to smite him, by which Jonathan knew that his father had determined to kill David. So there's an example right there. Jonathan risked his own life to save David. So the whole, it goes back to the whole thing, you know, you got to get through me to get to him. I've got his back. I've got him covered. So Jonathan arose from the table in fierce anger and ate no food for that second day of the month, for he grieved for David because his father had disgraced him. In the morning, Jonathan went out into the field at the same appointed time with David, and a little lad was with him. And he said to his lad, "Run, find the arrows which I shoot." And as the lad ran, he shot an arrow beyond him. When the lad came to the place where Jonathan had shot the arrow, Jonathan called to him, "Is not the arrow beyond you?" And Jonathan cried after the lad, "Make speed, haste, stay not." The lad gathered up the arrow and came to his master. But the lad knew nothing, only Jonathan and David knew the matter. Jonathan gave his weapons to his lad and told him, "Go, carry them to the city." And as soon as the lad was gone, David arose from beside the heap of stones and fell on his face to the ground and bowed himself three times. And they kissed one another and wept with one another until David got control of himself. Right there is a powerful thing. Okay, they wept and kissed and hugged each other, so much so, clung to each other, okay? I believe that as Ruth was clinging to Naomi, okay, David and Jonathan were clinging to each other, okay? And it was so much so that David had to get control of himself, okay? And Jonathan told David, "Go in peace, for as much as we have sworn to each other in the name of the Lord, saying, 'The Lord shall be between me and you and between my descendants and yours forever.'" And Jonathan arose and departed into the city. So there you have a powerful account of David and Jonathan. You know, just like we saw with Ruth and Naomi, it kind of mirrors that whole relationship between the two of them. Here you have a bond, an unbreakable bond, another situation right there where the only thing that was going to separate David and Jonathan was going to be death. And Jonathan actually displayed that out more out than in the situation with Ruth and Naomi. I mean, Jonathan actually did put his life at stake before his father, because his father could have killed him for what he was doing for Jonathan. So there's a clear-cut example right there of what covenant's about and what bonding is about. What it is to be in a true bonding relationship with somebody is you've got their back, they've got your back. You've got them covered, they've got you covered. You know, you put them before yourself. They, what they need, what they want, that's what it's about. What they say to you to do, you will do. No question, no hesitation, no, "Well, why?" You know, none of that. That's, and you see that so powerfully. You know, the story of David and Jonathan, that whole aspect of it goes into a little bit more of a detailed thing than within the first chapter of Ruth and Naomi, although you get a very strong sense of what took place with Ruth and Naomi. I'm not downplaying that at all. But there's a little bit more that goes about in the account of David and Jonathan. And you just see that powerful, powerful bond that took place between the two of them. You know, and the same thing. Nothing will separate. You know, Jonathan could, in essence, Jonathan said the same words to David that Ruth said to Naomi. "Your people are going to be my people. Where you go, where I go. The only thing that will separate you and I is death." You know, same exact thing. So there we have the two accounts of you know, Ruth and Naomi and David and Jonathan. I think two of the most powerful examples of bonding, of a covenant relationship that could take place in the Bible. So just a little bit to go into, wrap this up, about how we're in the week of bonding. You know, so during the sixth week of counting the Omer, we examine and refine the attribute of bonding. Bonding means connecting, not only feeling for another, but being attached to them. Not just a token commitment, but total devotion. It creates a channel between giver and receiver. Bonding is eternal. What do we know about covenant? Covenant's eternal, right? When you're in a right bonding with somebody, that's meant to be eternal. It develops an everlasting union that lives on forever through the perpetual fruit it bears. Bonding is the foundation of life, the emotional spine of the human mind. Every person needs bonding to flourish and grow. We kind of had a little lesson about this yesterday in our homeschool class, because a question came up. You know, well, what if you're somebody that doesn't need anybody? And as I was sitting there listening to my thought, you're asking the wrong person that question. You really are. Because I was in that place. I'm good alone. I don't need anybody. What? I'm all set. I'd be just fine on my own. I could take care of things, do whatever, okay? And somebody brought that up because they were kind of feeling that same way. And it's like, no, you know, how we answer them. It was like, the truth of the matter is, that's not the truth about anybody. That's not how Yahweh created us. All of us were created to have people in our lives. All of us were created to have certain covenant relationships, to bond with certain people. All of us were created to be nurturing and affectionate and to have that. Yahweh did not intend anybody, you know, me, Israel, you know, Kathy, he did not intend for us to be like, you're a one-man show. You're all set. You don't need anybody. You're going to go on and stuff. You know, and there's people, and like I said, been there, done that. I was one that's like, I don't need affection. I'm all set. I'm totally happy the way I am. I don't need affection. I'd be fine without it. I'm fine without hugging. I'm fine without touching, okay? And as we explained yesterday, when that came up, it was like, but that's not the truth. When you really delve deep into who you really are, and you get out of your head and tap into your heart, everybody needs it. Everybody needs affection. Everybody needs touch. Everybody needs a relationship with another person in their life. Everybody needs it. And we were talking about the example that Dad used to use all the time of that orphanage that was in Russia. And it was those babies that were dying. And why were these babies dying? Because there was nobody, they weren't getting touch. People that understand the importance of touch. There's so much, and that's why mom strives about touch all the time. What does she say? You know, when you're hugging somebody or when you meet somebody, touch them on purpose. You know, always, you know, you watch mom. Mom's always touching somebody. Even somebody that she meets for the first time. You always see her when she goes, you know, she puts her hand on their arm or on their shoulder or something, or oh, it's nice to meet you, because she knows the importance of touch. And she on purpose releases, and she knows that through touch you can transfer out of you into that person. And even if you don't say a word, you could be in a relationship with somebody, you know, whether it's a spouse or a close friend or whatever, you know what? And sometimes it's just enough for the two of you to be together. You don't even have to say a word. You don't have to say nothing at all. But you know what each other's heart is for each other. And especially when it comes to touch. You know, no words could take place, but when you know, when you feel, I mean, I'm sure all of us in here have experienced that at some point or another, you know, with somebody that is really important to us or we're really close to or whatever, and you go to, you know, you give them a hug or whatever, or you go to hug them goodbye, and then just that hug just does something. It was like, oh, I needed that hug. Oh, that hug just changes you, or you know, or something takes place. I can't really exactly find the word that I'm trying to think of right now, but I know for me, for personal experience, it's like I've had it happen many times in certain situations. Like, and I'm, you know, a situation happens, and the situation's over, and you know, mom's with me, involved in it, or whatever, and it's like, okay, and now we can go on, and we go to hug each other goodbye, but it's like, ah. I needed that hug. It was a comforting hug. It was a comforting moment. It was like, you know, all is well. And mom's so good displaying, all is well. Everything is all right. And, you know, that's an importance of touch. So even if you're with, whether it's a husband or a wife or a close friend, even if you're just sitting together and no words need to be spoken, but if you're, you know, give each other a hug or, you know, whatever, things take place just during that, with that touch. And in essence, touch is more powerful and communicates a more stronger message than words do. Words can be words. You know, in some situations, it's nothing for somebody, not us here, but you know, there's some situations where people can say, I love you, and it's just words, okay? That's totally different when it comes to the actual action behind the love. So, every person needs bonding to flourish and grow. I was just thinking, why did I get off on that? But it was like, okay, what we were talking about in class yesterday when somebody was like, well, I don't need anybody. That's not the truth. Everybody needs somebody. Everybody needs somebody. So The bonding between mother and child, between husband and wife, between brothers and sisters, between close friends. Bonding is affirmation. It gives one the sense of belonging, that I matter, I am significant and important. It establishes trust, trust in yourself and trust in others. It instills confidence. Without bonding and nurturing, we cannot realize and be ourselves. Without that true walking out, you can't truly be who Yahweh called you to be. So we're going to quickly look at each day of the week of bonding. So day 36, that day was called loving kindness of bonding. Love is the heart of bonding. You cannot bond without love. Love establishes a reliable base on which bonding can build. If you have a problem bonding, examine how much you love the one with which you wish to bond. And we talked about this on Sabbath. Do I try to bond without first fostering a loving attitude? Is my bonding expressed in a loving manner? And then, like we were saying on Sabbath, they gave a little exercise to do for that day to focus on. So for that day, it was demonstrate the bond you have with your child or friend through an act of love. Next day, day 37, was the discipline of bonding. Bonding must be done with discretion and careful consideration with whom and with what you bond. Like I said, you just don't bond with anybody. You know, we just don't walk down the street, we're going to go get gas afterwards at Abs, and, you know, I just don't decide, oh, I'm just going to bond with that person that just walked out the door of the gas station. That's not going to take place, okay? Even the healthiest and closest bonding needs time out, a respect for each individual space. Now, I had to actually add to something like to that, and this is my own thing. Me personally, okay, I'm not saying that's wrong or anything, but there's a slight part of me that doesn't quite agree with that. You know, there's times when we need space. You know, there's times when, I just need my own time for a while. But you got to be careful, though, when you start to get into that, okay? Been there, done that. I need to just go to Maine for 3 days by myself and not have anybody or anything around, okay? Is that a healthy thought or is it an unhealthy thought? Now, I'm not saying that there aren't times when it's been like, you know, I'm not saying that there aren't times when, yeah, okay, you know what, I just need a couple days to get alone with me and Yahweh to pray and to hear. And that's not what I'm talking about. That's all kosher to do. But I'm talking about if it's a running away aspect. Okay, when things, and we all know that things in the world seem to be like, blah, you know, and it can have the tendency to try to overwhelm you or to try to stress you. And in the midst of that overwhelming and stress and stuff, if you think that, you know, I'm just going to get in the car. And I think I may have said this about a month or so ago, so I guess I've got to work on getting this thought out of my head. You know, if I'm just going to get in the car and I'm just going to drive and keep driving until I end up, you know, and I'm rewriting my thinking, so until I end up in Vermont, okay? That's when you kind of have to question yourself and be like, okay, why am I honestly going that way? Why am I thinking I just need to drive and get away? So there's two different, you got to examine that type of thing. But, so do I overbond? Am I too dependent on the one I bond with? Is he too dependent on me? Do I bond out of desperation? Do I bond with healthy, wholesome people? So the exercise for that day was, review the discipline in your bonding experiences to see if it needs adjustment. You know, we all need to make adjustments in certain areas. And I know for me personally speaking, okay, I need to make adjustments in bonding. There's areas I need to make a definite adjustments in. And bonding is actually a big, big area for me personally. So day 38, which is tomorrow. So compassion in bonding. Bonding needs to be not only loving, but also compassionate. And so the questions are, is my bonding conditional? Do I withdraw when I am uncomfortable with the person I'm trying to bond with? And the exercise for that day was, be a support to somebody with whom you have bonded to. So, you know, everybody has different days, right? So my day may have been a little bit different than Kelsey's day, or my day would have been a little bit different than Jordan's day. You know, my day may have been a little bit different than Kenneth's day. Kathy's different day would have been a little bit different than Nicole's day. You know, everybody has, days may have been a little bit type of different, but how are we able to come along each other to make that different day the way it should have been turned out. If it was a day that didn't quite go the way we thought it was going to go. So day 39 is called the endurance in bonding. An essential component of bonding is its endurance, its ability to withstand challenges and setbacks. Without endurance, there's no chance to develop true bonding. Am I totally committed to the one with whom I bond? How much will I endure, and how ready am I to fight to maintain this bond? Is the person I bond with aware of my devotion? Exercise for that day is demonstrate the endurance level of your bonding by confronting a challenge that obstructs the bond. You know, and some of these, you know, I can, for me personally, as I read some of these, you know, I can be, honestly, you know, I'm gonna be honest. I don't know why, for some reason, I get up here and I all of a sudden just become transparent and honest, and I just like, well, say this stuff. Well, I know why, but it's like, you know, when as I read some of these for myself, and as I'm reading the questions and I'm trying to internalize them for myself, it's like, whoa, okay, that's a little bit pushing the edges, okay? It's like, that's a little bit pushing the wall there. So, next one, day 40, humility of bonding. Now, we talked about humility last week, okay? Humility is the absence of pride or arrogance. Well, you need to have humility in order to be bonding. So humility is crucial in healthy bonding. Arrogance divides people. Preoccupation with your own desires and needs separates you from others. Humility allows you to appreciate another person and bond with them. Healthy bonding is the union of two distinct people with independent personalities who join for a higher purpose than satisfying their own needs. True humility comes from recognizing and acknowledging God in your life. Am I aware of the third person, Yahweh, in bonding? And that this person gives me the capacity to unite with one another despite our distinctions. Exercise. When praying, acknowledge Yahweh specifically for helping you bond with others. Day 41. Bonding in bonding. Every person needs and has the capacity to bond with other people, with significant undertakings and with meaningful experiences. Do I have difficulty bonding? Is the difficulty in all areas or only in certain ones? Do I bond easily with my job but have trouble bonding with people, or vice versa? Examine the reasons for not bonding. Is it because I am too critical and find fault in everything as an excuse for not bonding? Am I too locked in my own ways? Is my not bonding a result of discomfort with vulnerability? Have I been hurt in my past bonding experiences? Has my trust been abused? Is my fear of bonding a result of the deficient bonding I experienced as a child? I would say that that's probably one of the most important day to examine out of this week. If you don't focus on any of the other days this week, focus on that one. Because I know those were questions I asked myself, okay? Those are powerful, powerful questions. Every one of them. Am I too locked in my own ways? I know I am. Temporarily right now, but Yahweh can change that. I need to do the work and effort to change it. Is my not bonding a result of discomfort with vulnerability? Well, I'm not the most vulnerable person at times, so I could say that that would apply to me. Have I been hurt in my past bonding experiences? You know, let's check that one off, okay? And that's probably a big one with most people. Has my trust been abused? Let's put a big red check on that one. That's a definite possibility. Yahweh knows the questions to ask to penetrate your inner self to help you get free. And whatever may have happened in the past, wherever old things that may have taken place, trust that has been abused, been there, done that, over, gone with for good. That shouldn't determine what now takes place in the future. Because trust has been abused in the past, we can't let it steal from what Yahweh has planned for us now and in the future. What relationships went bleh in the past that were painful or whatever, we need to learn to let those go. And I'm speaking to myself big time right now, okay? We need to let those go. Because it's only stopping us from enjoying the relationships that Yahweh has put in our lives now. It's only stopping us from not exploring the depthness of the relationships that Yahweh has each one of us in right now. Okay? All of us in here. You can think of the people in your own lives personally, you know, who you relate to, your relationships. I know it could speak with you know, me and my husband, you know, me and my daughter, you know, me and Unique, all right, me and Jordan, okay, me and Mom, me and other people that are sitting in this room, okay? All of each one of us can say things like that. We all know the people come to mind, and it's like, and we're accountable to make sure we rewrite that. So whether it's between husband and wife, whether it's between, you know, friend and friend, mother and daughter, father and daughter, father and son, mother and son, whatever. That is all key. And we need to take seriously, like I said, especially this day that is coming up. You know, we have a few days before we get to this day. And take it seriously. From the moment we wake up to the moment we go to bed, examine these questions. Is my fear of bonding a result of bonding I experienced as a child? Negative bonding. Bonding that was not the way it should have been. Okay? I can only speak for myself, but I can say, yeah. I know there's certain areas, certain experiences as a child growing up and stuff. There was bonding that was not there was bonding that never took place, or a certain bonding that was, you know, there was some bonding, but it wasn't quite up to par. Okay, there was certain things and it changed and altered me, who I was during those experiences, and what the devil has tried to keep me locked into. You know, we know about walls. Try to keep that wall around you and stuff. But Yahweh is, if not anything, now's the time. Yahweh is giving us this opportunity, this time that we're in right now with the counting of the Omer, this journey between Passover and Shavuot, this time to get completely free from anything and everything that the enemy may have done throughout our lives, from the time we were born to this present time now. Anything that may have taken place over this past year, okay? And we talk about it all the time, and Jordan brought it up. But there's a reason why we talk about it all the time. Because we're a family that went through a lot over the last year. Okay? And, you know, it could either, you know, if you have the choice to sit it out or dance, dance. Okay? If you have the choice to sit it out or dance, dance. No matter what has taken place over the past year, And it's all of us in here can say, most of us in here can say, very impactful experiences that had the opportunity to change some of us in a way that Yahweh did not intend it to change us, but Yahweh's good. And we've all gone on full speed ahead. And we've all bonded together tighter as a family. And we've all, you know, like Mom says all the time, we're at the head of the comet. But like I said, remember that. If you have the choice to sit it out or dance, make sure you dance, because that's what Yahweh wants. So to cultivate your capacity to bond, even if you have valid reasons to distrust, you must move past that and remember that Yahweh made you nurturing and loving, and learn to hear his voice within, which will allow you to experience other people's hearts and souls. Then you can slowly drop your defenses when you recognize someone you can truly trust. So the last thing I'm gonna end with right here is the important aspects of bonding and to have a true relationship, a strong relationship, and that consists of trust, commitment, and vulnerability. You got to be able to go there in those areas. You got to be able to be vulnerable. You got to be able to be like, okay, you know what? I'm committed. I'm in this to the end. You know, like we said, I think we said on Sabbath, Jordan may have said it or something, you know, the point of no return. And then trust. But like I said, you know, we're in this week of bonding, and we're all going somewhere. You know, we're going to Mount Sinai. We got this week, and we got next week. And we have the time, and like we said on Sabbath, even if you didn't do anything those first few weeks, you can rewrite. You can go back and rewrite those chapters of those weeks and then pick up now and carry out this week and next week in a whole different avenue that you ever have done before. And like I said, if you have the choice to sit it out or dance, dance. Amen. Well, I hope you all got something out of this tonight on Facebook. And we will see you back here at 11 a.m. on Sabbath.